No?
So I can tell you more about Islam. I can tell you more about Islam. Just to give you a brief introduction about Islam. So as Muslims, we believe in the one God. Okay, he's that one entity that's only worthy of worship. So as Muslims, we have a profession of faith where we say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. That basically means that we bear witness that, we bear witness there's no one worthy of worship except that one entity, that one one Allah. So we don't have any false deities that we associate with God. Because we believe that's the most important thing about religion, is Tawheed. As you mentioned already, Tawheed, the concept of one God, to not worship him without any other partners, just worship him, that one God. There's one amazing verse that as Muslims we recite in the Salah. It's a Surah Ikhlas. That basically is a surah that we believe is equivalent to one third of the Quran in its virtue. So what it means, just to give you a brief understanding, you be cold.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite cold in the UK. I know America is much more hot.
Yeah.
In the UK,
LA, bro.
In the LA as well. Yeah. LA is crazy hot in the UK. Yeah. To be fair, today is not that cold.
Yeah.
If you compare to like a couple of months ago, it was much more cold. It's much more cold. So I'm going to tell you more about the Surah Ikhlas. It's a beautiful verse in the, as Muslims, we recite every single day, Surah Ikhlas. So we say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ وَحَدْ اللَّهُ السَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُلَدْ وَلَمْ يَقُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. This is a beautiful verse that as Muslims we recite every single day in our Salah. And it's a beautiful verse. The reason why? Because it affirms the concept of Tawheed as Muslims we believe in. So we believe in that one God, he is self-sufficient. So we don't believe God is self-sufficient sometimes. We believe God is self-sufficient all times. Same thing, we believe God is eternal. And we believe God does not begot any son, or nor does he have any wives or any sisters. So this is the most important thing. How does that make all sense to you so far, the concept of God? I want to ask you a question, really important question. Do you believe in God? Do you believe in this one entity, this one power that's created the universe? Do you believe in the messengers? Do you believe in Jesus as a messenger?
Yeah.
Do you believe Moses is a messenger? Do you believe Muhammad is a messenger? You don't believe Muhammad is a messenger. May I ask you, why don't you believe Muhammad is a messenger?
A lot of reasons. I think this revelation, this first encounter.
Yep.
His revelation.
Yep.
His revelations about the Jewish people.
Okay.
His revelations about God.
Okay.
Tawheed. His revelations of the names of Allah.
Okay.
His revelations.
So can we expand on that? Some of the points that you mentioned.
Yeah.
We can expand. So for example, you said the names of Allah. Can you expand on that? Like, what do you mean about the names of Allah that you don't agree with?
Yeah.
Just to give you like a, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came with the same message, exactly the same message as the other prophets came with. So Moses, let me tell you why. I'll let you respond. I'm not sure why you're smiling, but it's okay. No problem.
It's arguable.
Yeah. Well, it's fine. Okay. Let's understand this then. So the Prophet Moses, he came to worship one God. We can see even in the Bible that Moses was prostrating on the floor and worshiping that one God. Abraham, he came to the message of worshiping one God. All the messengers in the Quran, they came to worship one God. Tell me where the Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him, did not come with a different message than the other prophets in regards to the concept of one God.
Yeah, he doesn't.
He doesn't. So he comes with the same message as the other prophets, right? In regards to the concept of God.
Daniel.
Oh yeah, the son of man, Daniel 7. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's my mistake. Yeah. So do you know Daniel 7?
Can you expand on that, please?
Okay, so you've never heard of Daniel 7.
Can you expand on that?
You have to read it.
No, but I just want to speak about the concept of one God. So we're...
Yeah. It's poignant,
yeah.
Actually.
Well, you're not a Christian, right?
No, I am.
Oh, you're a Christian? Yeah. Okay, so I was a bit confused. You said you're searching for the truth.
Always.
So if you're searching for the truth, then I wanted to ask you that, what, did Prophet Muhammad come with a different teaching than the other prophets?
Yeah.
So in regards to the concept of one God, he did not come with a different message.
So what you're doing is a fallacy.
Okay, why is it a fallacy?
So I believe it's strong, man.
Okay.
You're presenting a question,
yeah,
and you're only getting one answer.
No,
So I don't... Thank you. What was your name again?
My name's Osama. What's your name?
My name's David.
Osama. Osama.
Dude, your zeal is insane. Your zeal, you know, zeal?
Yeah.
Charisma?
Yeah.
Bro, it's powerful.
Appreciate that.
I love it. Man, I'm so glad that you're alive.
Yeah.
Because, oh man, dude, I'm going to get your question.
Yeah.
This world is falling apart, bro.
I agree with you.
And you want truth, right?
Absolutely, yeah. We all want truth.
Oh, it's so refreshing, bro.
Yeah.
For the longest time, used to be an atheist.
Yeah.
Really struggled. Hard.
Okay.
And, I mean, for a young age, man, I was like, why does no one care? So I'm glad that you do, bro.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course, because we believe the most important element of every single religion is the concept of God. Every religion will tell you the most important, the foundation is the concept of God. So the most important thing that we've been speaking about is the concept of God. Why? Because the purpose of existence. Why we all exist? God has created us. If God has created us, he must have created us with a purpose.
Yes.
Are we on the same page right now, yeah? Yes. Fantastic. So if God created us, he must have created us with a purpose.
Yes.
So in order for us to understand the purpose of our existence, we have to go back to the divine revelations that God has given to us via the messengers, right? So when we go to the messengers, for example, I believe as a Muslim, you're right? I believe as a Muslim, if I was living at the time of Jesus, I'd have to follow Jesus in order to have my salvation. If I was living at the time of Moses, I'd have to follow Moses in order to have my salvation. And what I was mentioning you is the interesting concept of Tawheed. We worship one God, that one entity, without any partners. We don't associate any false teachers with our God. Because I believe that's the most disrespectful thing that you could do to your God. The most disservice thing you could do to your God is not to follow him according to his teachings.
Yes.
To follow him according to his desires.
Yes.
Let me give you an example, actually.
Can I answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely, go for it.
Yeah. So,
what question are you answering? Sorry, because I'll speak in a bit after that.
Why don't trust
About the concept of one God. Yeah, go for it.
So, you've probably heard this a billion times. How long have you been here in the Spirit's Corner?
Yeah, I've been a couple of years to be fair.
So you've heard, you know, three in one kind of deal. The Trinity.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You believe in that, by the way, just to clarify. Really? Don't you think that's a contradiction?
No, I can explain it. It's really well.
That's fine. Go for it.
But not right now.
I have to go more hard with that.
I do want to stick with the first question.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. But I do believe the foundation is about God. But that's fine. If you want to speak about Muhammad, if you have any questions, go for it. Yeah.
If you want to start here, I would love to engage in the conversation.
Would you actually like a mic?
Please tell me.
Let's just have a conversation. Yeah. Let's just have a conversation.
Mics off.
I don't mind. You had the question about Muhammad. If you don't mind, you can ask me the question about Muhammad.
So,
go for it. Peace be upon him.
Muhammad's deity, that's what we're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Not genie, sorry.
Yeah, it's prophethood and the concept of one God.
Yeah. So, the Trinity is a long talk.
Okay.
And Muhammad, let's stick with that one.
Yeah, go for it. Let's go. Let's speak about Muhammad. Peace be upon him. No problem.
Yeah. So, where do we start? Yeah. What hadiths do you believe? It's not Surah. Correct me if I'm wrong. So like the hadith of Aisha.
Yes.
Do you think it's real?
Yes. Okay. Absolutely. So do you want me to explain on that?
No.
That's fine.
So I'm gonna read something real quick. Is that all right?
Yeah. Go for it. No problem.
This is why I have a hard time.
Okay. No problem. Are you gonna talk about Aisha?
Not right now,
that's fine, no problem. You got a full notepad, yeah? About the question that you got.
Because I haven't memorized.
Yeah, that's fine, no problem at all.
Hopefully, I can find it.
Yeah, that's fine. But to be fair, if there's something about Islam that you think that may cause you doubt, that's something that should stick in your heart, to be fair, shouldn't it?
Nothing in Islam has ever caused me doubt.
So, like, because you mentioned Aisha straight away, so I do believe it's quite important that you mentioned it, because it would make sense if you spoke about a topic that you may believe there's a bit of a doubt about. I think it's fair if you have a discussion about it. Do you think that's all right?
Never talked about doubting Aisha.
No, but you mentioned about...
I just said, do you believe...
Yeah, so there's a reason why you asked me that question, don't you think?
No.
Why?
I just wanted to see, because I've talked to Muslims and I've read this verse.
Yeah.
And they said it's an unreliable hadith.
About the Prophet's marriage to Aisha? With Allah.
So it's Sahih al-Baqi, volume 9.
Yep.
Do you think that's reliable?
Yeah, let me just hear that. That's not, we don't believe that's authentic, yeah.
So you don't believe
it? Yeah, we don't believe that's authentic. Yeah.
I should put it away.
That's fine, no problem.
I've talked to Muslims that do.
Yeah. You have a problem with Aisha's marriage to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, by the way.
So,
generally speaking,
most Westerners,
yeah.
You do believe that she was not incorrect?
Yep. Okay. Absolutely.
So, most Westerners, they use it as an argument towards lots of people.
Yeah.
They say he was a pedophile.
Yeah.
I've heard all the responses.
Yeah.
And with your zeal and with your charisma, I don't want to be rude or assumption,
but fine.
I do know your answer.
No, absolutely.
You
can give me your opinion. That's not a problem at all.
No,
that's fine.
As a Westerner, you probably know my opinion.
Yeah.
So I think it's the end of the world.
Yeah.
I think it's strange, but I'm a Westerner, different culture. But I don't care about that.
Yeah. You're here for the truth, like you said, yeah?
Yeah.
So you're here for the truth. So let's speak about the truth now.
Yeah, yeah,
let's speak about the foundations. I'm going to quickly clarify about Aisha with Allah. I do believe it's quite important. Just if you give me 30 seconds. The reason why?
I would really love to answer the question about Muhammad.
That's fine. Go and answer the question.
Thank you so much.
Yes. I've been waiting a couple of minutes for it, so go for it.
Are you rushed?
No. I'm just wondering, like, what is your point? That's all the only thing. I'm just wondering, like, what question you have. Take your time, but I'm just wondering, what is your question? Yeah.
I want it to be a conversation.
That's fine. Cool. We're not going to have a debate or anything. It's going to be a discussion.
Cool. So, Muhammad's revelation, when he received it, it was different from any other prophet.
Okay.
Radically different.
Okay.
His revelations were radically different.
Okay.
His characteristics, his journey were radically different from any other prophet. The way God or Allah encountered Muhammad was radically different from any other prophet.
Okay.
Muhammad goes, the Quran goes different. It goes against every other scripture in the Bible.
Can you give us some examples, please?
Yeah, are you a Jew?
No, I'm a Muslim.
Why?
Because I believe Allah has, from His wisdom, He sent the divine revelation, which is the Quran. And Prophet Muhammad conveyed it to his people. And not just that, I believe in the Quran because I believe it's a truth.
Why?
I'm not a blind follower. Of course, there's many.
I
can give you many reasons why. So one of the miracles is I believe the Quran. The Quran that we have. Yeah, if you could let me finish, please. Yeah, if you don't mind.
Sure.
No, I just want to give. I want to answer your question. Best
of my
ability.
It wasn't my question. That's okay. Problem. So you're answering a question I didn't ask.
No.
If it's because
you asked me, like, do you believe Islam is the truth? You believe Prophet Muhammad is the truth? You asked me this question.
I asked you. My original question, I asked you, why are you not a Jew?
Yeah.
And then you said, I'm a Muslim.
But when you say Jew, it depends on the tribe as well, to be fair. Because when it comes to Judaism, you can only be an Israelite in order to be a Jew, to be fair. Yeah.
So then I asked, why are you a Muslim?
Yeah.
So I'm not concerned.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah,
so
okay.
Let me clarify.
Okay, go for it, yeah.
So when I said, why are you a Muslim?
Yeah.
I should have been more specific. I'm sorry.
All right.
When I asked why you're Muslim, I said, I guess I inferred in my own mind, let me communicate a little bit better.
Yeah.
Is you're a Muslim, but you're not a Jew.
Yeah.
Why? Because Muhammad came with a different revelation.
Okay.
Otherwise, you would probably be Jewish.
No.
So why are Jews not following the revelation
of
Muhammad?
Can I respond to that? That's the question you asked. If you don't mind, can I respond to that? So firstly, at the time of Medina, when the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, migrated to Medina, it was a heavy Jew population. So many of the individuals that were Jews converted to Islam because they knew that this was a prophet that was prophesied about them in the Torah. And not only that, can I respond?
Okay, yeah.
There was, of course, many Jews, many Christians alike that rejected the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But at the same time, there was many Jews in the Arabian Peninsula and Christians that accepted the Prophet Muhammad as the Lord. As for example, Judaism, we don't believe the Judaism is the truth. And the reason behind that is you can only be born in Israelite in order for you to be a Jew. And we don't believe the salvation is because of your ethnicity. So we believe Islam, in the Quran, many times it mentions that Islam is for the whole of mankind.
So you don't believe that you can become, you don't believe that.
You cannot become a Jew. Even if you ask a Jew, you cannot become an Israelite. So it wouldn't be a fair religion. But can I just, I think it's really important for me to clarify a couple of questions.
That's not true.
No, there's a lot, you can respond in your time, not a problem. There's a lot of points that you mentioned. I gave you a lot of time to speak as well. I do believe it's fair if you just give me a bit of a chance as well, just so I can give a response and that maybe you can understand and be satisfied with as well. So of course, when it comes to the Jewish individuals, many of them have become a Muslim. Because they understood that this was the prophet that was prophesied about them in the Torah. So we can see that that's a clear fact. In Medina as well, there was a heavy Jew population that accepted Islam as the truth. And firstly, that's not the criteria. The criteria is if the Quran is the truth, if the Prophet Muhammad was a truthful individual that came with the divine revelations, then by default, you would have to accept it no matter what tribe you are, no matter what is your religious system, no matter what is your belief. At that time in Arabia, there was many individuals that were worshipping pagan idols, okay? So it doesn't matter what they were doing, if they have to accept the truth. Because we don't believe, like, for example, I remember I repeated to you at that time, if he was living at the time of Moses, of course, to the people of and the children of Israel, you would have to follow Musa alayhi salam in order to have your salvations. And we believe Moses came with the Torah. So we believe he came with divine revelation as well. But afterwards, once the scriptures was changed, because in the Quran we believe, Allah says, woe to those individuals that have written the scripture from their own hand. So those individuals, they distorted the verses according to their own desires.
What verses were distorted?
So in the Torah, in the Old Testament and New Testament, it's clearly and was well known that the Bible has not been preserved. And clearly, we can see the revelations that we have right now, according to Christian scholars as well, and even according to ex-Christian scholars, they're all, even to be fair, there's an individual in the park that even said that the Bible is not perfect, and neither do they make the claim that the Bible is perfect. So that's, we can clearly see that if the revelation has not been preserved, how can I follow a revelation that has not been preserved and has been corrupted? So that you can go back to your element is that you said that the Prophet Muhammad SAW was not a Jew, therefore you're not going to be following him. Is that the claim that you're making, or are you trying to say that why am I not a Jew? Can you expand? Can you clarify?
Muhammad came with a different revelation, and that's why you're not a Jew.
Okay,
it's kind of satirical.
Did Moses come with a different revelation?
No.
What revelation did he come with?
From different. I mean, he.
Is the Torah different to the Injil? Is the Old Testament different to the Old New Testament?
No.
So are they the same thing?
Yeah.
And they were to the same people?
Yeah.
No,
to the Gentiles and to the Jew.
No, Romans, wait, the Old 12. Testament was given to a different nation, right? So at that time when Moses was living in, it was given to his nation. The New Testament, according to your belief, just clarify. According
it's
to
funny,
your belief,
it's funny, you understand.
According to your belief, it was given to by Jesus, and he was conveyed to his people. So look, for example, before Moses as well, do you believe there was prophets that were giving divine revelation before Moses? I want to clarify. I want to understand from your perspective.
No, I'm just laughing because I'm realizing that you don't understand.
No, I want to ask you a question.
Before
Moses, do you believe there was prophets that had revelations that conveyed to the people?
Before Moses. I believe, there's a little sketchy stuff about Enoch. You have the book of Enoch.
Okay.
I don't believe it was canon.
Okay.
But they all came with the same message.
Yeah, so they all came with the same message. So when you say the same message but different revelations.
So there's one God.
Yep.
And they tell you, hey, this is what you do. This is what
okay.
you do.
And if the revelation is corrupted, would you still follow it?
So, if the revelation was corrupted...
Yeah, would you still follow it? So why do you follow the New Testament then?
Because it's not corrupt.
Do you know the authors of the Old New Testament?
What was that?
Do you know the authors of the New Testament?
I know most of them.
Sorry?
I know most of them.
Okay, so do you know John Matthew? Do we know his biography?
Do we know John's biography?
Yeah.
We're talking about the...
The authors of the Bible. Do we know John and Matthew's biography?
Do we know... I'm confused. You're speaking
Do we know the biography of John and Matthew? Do you know where they're from? Do you know how old were they? Do you know if these individuals saw Jesus?
Yeah.
Okay, just to clarify,
did
Matthew and John see Jesus?
The disciples Matthew and John saw Jesus.
No.
So the disciples Matthew and John didn't see Jesus?
No.
That's crazy.
As in, did they meet Jesus? Were they physical companions with Jesus? They were not.
The disciples Matthew and John?
Yeah. The individuals that wrote Matthew... The individuals that wrote John, of course, you believe as Christians that they were inspired by God and they wrote the revelations down.
Yeah.
Do those individuals meet Jesus? Did they see Jesus?
I don't think
Forget
so.
Even meeting.
Yeah, I don't think so.
So they haven't met Jesus.
Yeah.
So you're trusting...
I don't know, though. I haven't looked into it.
That's what I'm trying to say to you. So if you're believing in the revelation where those individuals have not even seen Jesus or even met Jesus, how can you take their word as the book of truth? How can you take their word?
I can tell
how?
You.
You don't even know those individuals. They never. Like, imagine that I haven't even met you. I haven't even met you, and you're claiming to be a prophet of God. I haven't even met you. You came with the divine revelation. I do not follow you, and I still accept you as the truth, even though I've never met you, never seen you, and plus, no companions that have directly met you have conveyed the message.
So, what you're doing, it's called inferring.
Okay.
And I get it, you're really zealous. You've heard a lot of these...
Zealous?
Yeah, zealous.
Okay.
Is that wrong?
Fine, go carry on.
Is it derogatory?
What does zealous mean?
It means passionate.
Okay.
And so,
can we, if you don't mind, can we go back to the topic that you're mentioning, please? Eh? So, about the New Testament, why do you follow it? If the disciples have never even met Jesus, how can you,
haven't met Jesus.
I take that back. Not disciples, John, Matthew, the individuals that have written the New Testament, that have so-called been inspired by God and written the revelations, those individuals have never met Jesus, never even seen Jesus. How can you take that as a truth?
I'm about to blow your mind, ready?
Go for it.
It doesn't matter who wrote it.
Excuse me?
Yeah, boom.
Wait, so it doesn't matter. Wait. Let's analyze that.
Yeah.
So we do not know who wrote the Bible. We do not know...
Okay, this is a fallacy of generalization.
No, okay, let's analyze this then. So
you're
we don't
doing
know...
A fallacy
we,
of
like you said, no, I'm going to say you're mentioned. We don't need to know who wrote the Bible, right?
No. Okay.
And okay, wait one second. We don't need to know who wrote the Bible, and neither do they have to meet Jesus in order for them to say that they have divine revelation from the Bible.
Okay,
yes?
Can I explain what you're doing?
No,
right
can
now?
You clarify, please?
Yes. So what you're doing
and
right now.
Firstly, now we have to understand this. No, this is important to be fair. This is important.
Okay,
no, I spoke I let you speak for a really long time to be fair. I've been really patient with you. No, I've been really patient with you. I'm kind of seeing what you're doing now, yeah?
So
let me finish, please, yeah? So if those individuals have never met Jesus, they've never seen Jesus, and they have so-called got some interpretation from their mind that
they
this
didn't.
Is,
they
wait,
didn't.
Wait,
it's
wait,
not true.
Wait. No, because
true.
Look, those individuals.
You're not,
wait.
You're
no,
lying.
Let me. Okay, if I'm lying, you can clarify. You can clarify. No problem.
Okay.
If I'm lying, you can provide evidences. Wait. Let me clarify what I'm saying. So those individuals, they've never seen Jesus. They never met him. They've claimed that
we don't know that.
They've
for
claimed.
A fact.
They've
we
claimed.
Don't know that for a
they've
fact.
Claimed. This is a fact, by the way. You can search this up. And then they claim that those individuals have received inspiration from God. from God.
Have you ever heard of Mark and Luke?
Can that please finish? Can that please finish?
You know, I recommend you purchase a book called Who Wrote the Bible by Richard Friedman. Read that book.
Okay. We cannot trust a source that we don't even know who written it. We cannot trust a source. If an individual makes a claim that I've written, I've received revelation from God. I've written it down, and I've said I've met God. I've seen God telling me to say this. I have not even met the individual. I have not even seen this individual, and I've claimed I've seen his biography. I've seen his lifestyle. Jesus did this.
You're
Jesus did that.
Islamic beliefs.
No,
and
this is okay. This is logic. This is logic.
No, it's
this
not.
Is logic. This
no,
is logic.
It's not.
I have
you
not
trust
even
in a forged document.
Can you? Okay, so what you guys are doing right now, if you were to do this anywhere, if you do this in a public
let's
classroom,
prove, let's prove there's forgery
like
in the Bible. If this
so,
is,
like,
if,
can I okay, go on conversation. So, what you're doing, and I'm trying to, because I really genuinely, I actually do care about you. I didn't come here to argue.
Well, neither am I, but
and
it's the truth.
It's a little, I'm realizing right now, you're right, it's a little bit different of a culture. I'm kind of realizing that right now. There is more of an argument, and it's not a bad thing. It's a little bit more argumentative. So what I was trying to do before, I was going really slow.
Yeah.
I was talking really slow. It's because it's a different culture.
Yeah, let's talk about the foundations,
so,
to be fair. With all due respect, I think there's a lot of
conversation.
We've been diverting
there's
a lot.
No way.
It's been like 20 minutes we've been diverting
but
a lot, to be fair.
It's a conversation.
Yeah, but to be honest, if you want the truth, then we have to speak about the crux of the matter.
Exactly.
If you're not here to speak about the crux of the matter, that's up to you. That's not a problem at all.
That's not what I'm doing.
You said you're here for the truth.
This is actually gnarly. This could make me
you
cry.
Said you said you're here for the truth, but to be fair,
I don't want to have a conversation with you.
Okay, that's what I mean.
What if I actually love you?
Yeah, but if you're on two different pages, you can't have a conversation.
I know, and that's what I really.
But you're not addressing his point.
But you.
You're just saying that it's
talk.
Irrelevant.
You
irrelevant.
Have to let me talk.
No, like, but he did let you.
To be honest, even on camera as well, it was really patient. The first 10 minutes, I let you speak. We were
patience,
speaking about different topics.
Patience.
Wait. And I'm here for the truth. And like I said, if you're here for the truth, let's have a discussion. If you're not here for the truth, that's fine. We can both end the discussion right now. If you want to answer my question about not seeing those individuals that have never met or seen Jesus, and then narrating a whole story about Jesus, a person that they never met, you can clarify that now.
Okay.
Go for it. I'll let you speak.
So patience. Let me just
please, like,
this.
If you can. With all due respect, let's not speak about our life story or your life story. Let's talk about the topic. And I won't interrupt you, it's not a problem. You can speak about the topic, but let's not talk about something else.
If you want to have a conversation, you can't have a conversation without any confrontation.
Yeah.
It is going to be uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Conversation,
I know it's uncomfortable. But
yeah, maybe it's uncomfortable, to be fair, because it's your beliefs. I understand you're passionate about your beliefs as well.
Exactly.
I understand. Wait.
So,
I think you speak over it, but I'm
okay,
just,
so,
let's speak about the topic,
okay.
Yeah?
So what this is, I see what's going on here. So you're taking Islamic beliefs, because you have the hadith, you have the biography. I mean, in every hadith, it's incredible. It really is. It's written in the original language. It's written in the Arabic.
Yeah.
You have names from every single person. You
change narrations,
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you are born as a Muslim, right?
Yeah.
Born Muslim?
Every baby is born with fitrah,
Okay, so what you're doing is you're taking your Islamic perspectives and you're putting them on the Bible. And of course, it doesn't make sense to you.
But I disagree with you, though.
I know you disagree.
Of course we will, because we have a higher standard than yours.
Yeah.
You've lowered your standards.
So that's also a fallacy. It's
and you've even praised the Hadith methodology.
Yeah.
So
I'm saying it's impressive that you guys have
do you have anything like that with the New Testament?
Yes, we do. Read
no,
Matthew.
You don't. All they say is they've interviewed the eyewitnesses, but you don't know the names of the eyewitnesses. You have nothing.
We do. Okay, so
they never even met them. They never even met Jesus.
It's actually quite ridiculous.
I want you to reply. Look, I said I made a statement. I want you to refute me.
What was your statement?
I want you to refute me.
Just to make sure.
Those
so
individuals
get,
did not even see Jesus. They never met Jesus.
So the individuals of Matthew and John.
You said what was my statement,
right?
But you didn't let me respond with it.
Sorry. Do you forgive me?
No problem. So I was saying that those individuals have never met Jesus. They've never seen Jesus, and they've claimed that they've received inspiration from God to write down the revelations. Are you listening? Are you listening?
I've
so those individuals
Bible,
that we have, so those people that have not even seen or met Jesus, how can we take them their words as truth when they never even met the person? Neither have they seen the person.
Yeah. What do you want
Please.
Me to read?
So I just want to just read this. As you said, we don't
have I want this conversation to be productive, but
okay, yeah,
I don't believe it's getting anywhere. To be fair with you.
So,
but if you answer my question, that'll be really helpful for me.
Okay, cool.
For me to understand your perspective, and I will let you speak.
Okay, cool. Thank you. So. And do we know who wrote? He's saying we don't know who wrote John and Matthew. I haven't done actually a lot of research.
It doesn't establish
on
anything.
John
and Matthew.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. So, but he's saying he's doing this thing where he's saying, and I don't mean it to be discriminatory.
I just want you to respond to my point.
So,
to be fair, but if you want to analyze the topic,
let's
that's fine.
Let's establish forgeries in the Bible. Let's see why Matthew's a reliable source of information.
To be fair, okay, do you want to speak?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, go for it.
Yeah, I'll let you speak. And I'm not doing this to be rude, but I really want to...
Let's address...
You're not really engaging this
point. I'll be honest with you, you're not engaging at all.
But you're not letting me.
At all. I'm trying my best to, but you're not engaging at all. Like, you're talking about the stories, you're talking about different narrations, but I will let you speak, no problem. I've said that 3-4 times now, but you're not talking about the topic that I want you to talk about, so please speak about the topic that we're mentioning. If you're speaking about something else, I don't believe it's going to be a productive conversation, in my humble opinion. So if you want to speak about the John and Matthew, that those individuals have never seen or met Jesus, and I said to you, like, as a logical person, not just randomly, as a logical person, I said to you that I cannot trust an individual that has never met the person, and at the same time has written a whole narration about him, a whole biography, and mentioning things that that contradict the nature of his own. Because I believe that we should only worship one God. If an individual is trying to venerate a person, even though he's not met him, and he's making a claim that this individual is saying something, even though he's not met him, that's not logical for me to believe in. Please respond to that point.
So you're saying Matthew, we don't know who wrote Matthew and John. Can you show me that? Can you show me? Do you have any documents?
It's well known and it's well proven. It's ma'ruf. You can even do your own research. Wait, can I... Okay, you asked me a question. And you're laughing.
I'm laughing because it's comical.
You're too busy. You know what you're doing. You know one thing you're doing. You're too busy analyzing the discussion rather than talking about the points that we've discussed.
You are right.
You're more analyzing the discussion. This person is doing this. This person is...
Because I
this
care
debate
about
is this. This
not...
conversation is not going anywhere, to be fair.
Because yeah. I care
this conversation
about
is not going anywhere.
Because we have two different agendas.
Fair. No, look, if you were sincere, you would engage with the topics. But because I believe you're not sincere and you're too busy analyzing the conversation, instead of actually answering my points, this conversation is not going to go anywhere. I understand this is your first time in Speaker's Corner. I understand that. I'm trying to be respectful as much as possible, but unfortunately, you're not addressing my points.
So if you want to
end the discussion, let's do it here, because it's been like 20, 30 minutes, and the conversation, unfortunately, has not gone anywhere. So with all due respect, I'm going to end the conversation, because it's not going anywhere. So I do apologize. I wanted this conversation to be fruitful, but if you're not addressing my points or engaging with my points, it cannot go anywhere. Maybe you can speak with someone else. You can get a better understanding with them. But to be fair, if you're not able to explain the foundations of your religion, which is the scriptures and who wrote them and the biography of those individuals, the whole religion is flawed. Thank you very much. I'm going to end the conversation. Goodbye.